So I know a lot of you guys have been thinking that I've filmed videos in my garage to try to show off. You know, I'm trying to stunt, show off my turbo kit and all that good stuff. But in reality, I want to be very clear. There are several months out of the year that I very much regret choosing this scene as the backdrop for my videos. And this is around that time because we just had a huge winter storm. It's definitely in the single digits outside and I just got back from vacation. So I've been trying to be patient to catch up on videos, but you know, we got to do what we got to do. So with that in mind, we are back in my garage for another video. And today we are going to talk about dynos. Let's just go ahead and jump into it. Now, as always, for everybody that's new to the channel, I create these videos to help keep you updated on the latest developments in our community, as well as discuss technical topics so that we have a better understanding of how our engines work. So if you're interested in more videos like that, be sure to subscribe because there will be a lot more coming out in the future. So obviously dynos are a huge talking point in the car community because it tells you how much power your car makes and everybody wants to know how much power their car makes. It's an easy metric to kind of compare cars and just have a good idea of where your car stacks up. But there's a lot to understand there before you just jump into the horsepower figure. So let's talk about dynos a little bit more. First thing you got to understand is there are different types of dynos. The first one that we all kind of started with is an engine dyno. And this is key because it tells you exactly how much power is coming out of the engine. The only trick is you need the engine on a stand so that you can connect it to the dyno to measure and calculate the horsepower. This is really difficult for most of us because we don't want to remove the engine from our car every time we want to see how much power it's making or how different changes affect the engine's performance. But it works really well for companies, you know, OEMs that are testing and developing their cars, or companies that just build and ship crate engines. That's a really easy way for them to make sure the engine is healthy and maybe even develop a base map to send to the owner once they get the engine installed in their car. But for those of us that are just modifying economy cars for no reason, thankfully they also make chassis dynos. And the way that a chassis dyno works is it has rollers that you can just drive onto, and as you accelerate the car, it measures how much power is coming out at the wheels. So instead of measuring your engine horsepower, it's measuring how much power is coming down to the tire at your wheels. So this is really nice because it tells you how much power you're actually putting to the ground, but it is a little more difficult to compare, especially with posted numbers from companies and stuff, because those are typically rated at the engine. Now there is a third option. There are hub dynos. They're not as popular, but basically the way that you get on those is you remove the wheels and you bolt the dyno directly onto the hub of the car. And then basically you do the same thing. You accelerate and it calculates how much horsepower is coming from the hub. So that kind of eliminates some variables like wheel and tire packages from the calculation, but it can still give you a pretty good representative number of how much power your car is making. Now, in order for a dyno to work, a couple things need to be true. The first is the dyno needs to have a known amount of resistance because it's doing a lot of calculations and it needs some baseline information. Now, on an engine dyno, a really popular way of doing that is basically having a set amount of resistance inside of the dyno where the engine is turning a shaft that is turning inside of a water-filled chamber, and that water creates resistance. So it knows as it's trying to churn and turn within that chamber, the water is creating resistance and increasing heat, and it also has a strain gauge inside of the dyno that can measure how hard the engine is trying to turn against the resistance in that chamber. So that's how it calculates how much power the engine is making. Another example is on a chassis dyno. If you have rollers with a set amount of weight, they know how hard it is to turn that roller over, and it's able to measure how quickly the speed of the roller is changing, and that determines how much power the car is making as well. So using that data, it's able to calculate your horsepower. Now, there are two main things that a dyno is measuring, and a lot of you are probably thinking it's horsepower and torque, but you got to remember that horsepower is not something that you can actually measure. It's something that you calculate. So in order to figure that out, a dyno needs to know torque that it can measure, but it also measures speed or RPM. And because it can measure those two things, it can in turn calculate horsepower. So it's critical that it can get an accurate torque reading as well as an accurate RPM reading in order to give you an accurate calculation of horsepower. Because again, horsepower is just a unit of power, which is a rate of work or work over time. So it's not something that you can just inherently measure. And no, horsepower is not a made up number. If you guys want me to talk about that in another video, we can definitely get into that argument because that's something that I feel very strongly about. But horsepower is just as, if not more important than torque. It's just something that you need to calculate to know the figure. Now let's talk about the different types of horsepower, because a lot of us like to talk about brake horsepower versus wheel horsepower. Which one is more accurate? Which one is more important? You know, all that good stuff. And like most things, I would say it depends. Brake horsepower is definitely important, especially when you're focusing on engine tuning, because if you want to know the differences in performance with certain mods, it's nice to compare brake horsepower, because that should be very similar between a lot of different cars. When you look at wheel horsepower, it is affected by your drivetrain losses, and that can be affected by a lot of different things. I know somebody sent me some dyno numbers and they didn't understand why their car was making power that was so low for the mods that they were using. But then I realized that they had really heavy wheels, really wide tires, and it looked cool, but that was robbing them of power because all the extra weight and resistance from the wide tires was causing extra drivetrain losses. So they were losing power going from the engine to the wheels. So that's why I think in some cases, the brake horsepower is maybe better for comparison purposes, because you just want to know how much power the engine is working. But wheel horsepower is still very important because that's how much your car is actually putting down to the ground. And if you want to compare it to your friends and you're wondering what's wrong, you could see in that instance, oh, it's because you've got a lot of extra resistance in your drivetrain. And if you want to get better performance, you run lighter wheels, you run better tires, you run more lightweight components throughout your drivetrain, whether it's a driveshaft or, you know, whatever, and that reduces your drivetrain losses, so more of your engine horsepower makes it to the wheels. So both of them are important, especially when you're comparing between cars. It just kind of depends on what you're trying to look at, whether it's performance or actual changes in your engine. Now, the thing that does bug me is when you're looking at a chassis dyno and trying to calculate brake horsepower, it is something that's kind of up in the air because the dyno can only measure torque at the wheels. So what you'll see in some cases is after you do a pull, they'll put the car in neutral and let it coast and slow down on its own. And what the dyno will do is it will try to calculate drivetrain losses by measuring how long it takes for the car to slow down and how much resistance is, you know, inherently in your drivetrain that causes the car to brake even with no power or brakes being applied. You just put the car in neutral and let it coast to a stop or to a set speed. Now, I'm not really a fan of this. I think if you're using a dyno that measures power or torque at the wheels, then you should just report what it's making at the wheels. But I understand the strategy. It seems like a lot of them give, you know, pretty representative numbers for what people are looking for. So if you're using the same dyno before and after, it's probably fine. But as I've said before, you know, I'm a fan of dynojets. Pretty much all the dynos you see me post are on dynojets. And I just like them because they measure torque at the wheels. So they report torque at the wheels and calculate horsepower at the wheels. And that's what is most important to me when I'm trying to determine how my car should perform. Also, I find that they're really consistent, even if I go between dyno shops and stuff like that. With the correction factors, you know, that's a point that you want to make sure is the same, but generally it's very consistent. You'll also see a lot of tuners like MHD, they always report their numbers in dynojet figures. Boot Mode reports their numbers in dynojet figures. A lot of other tuners you'll see will report in dynojet, like Mike Body and pretty much everybody. You'll see they try to post their numbers with dynojet figures if they're available, just because those are the easiest to compare. And like I said, in my experience, they are the most consistent. So personal preference, do what you've got with what you have, but picking a dyno that you're going to use and compare before and after and staying consistent with that is more important than picking a certain brand. I also personally think that drivetrain losses are a lot lower than what people think, because people always ask me, you know, if our car makes this amount of wheel horsepower, how much is it making at the crank? And you really can't calculate that or guess that. A lot of things that our cars have inherently are designed to reduce drivetrain losses because it also increases fuel economy. So lightweight materials, additional coatings, you know, lubricants and stuff, things like running 0W20 oil, that makes the car's engine rotate more freely, so you're not going to have as much drivetrain losses as if you're using 5W40 or 10W60, like some of these older BMW or M series engines used to use. So it's not really accurate to say a car from the 1990s had 15% drivetrain losses, so a car from 2024 also should be using that same factor. I don't believe that's true, and that's why I don't like to guess how much brake horsepower the car is making based on a wheel horsepower calculation. Just report what the dyno reads. You know, it's not really worth trying to guess because it's probably not what you think, especially as you add horsepower. The percentage calculation becomes ridiculous. You know, if you're making 800 wheel horsepower, you're not losing 150 wheel horsepower just from the drivetrain. That's not even realistic. So it gets to a point where it's just not even useful information anymore.